John 12, verse 12 to 19. The next day, the large crowd that had come to the Passover festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Praise God! God bless him who comes in the name of the Lord. God bless the King of Israel." Jesus found a donkey and rode on it, just as the scripture says. "Do not be afraid, city of Zion. Here comes your king, riding on a young donkey." His disciples did not understand this at the time, but when Jesus had been raised to glory, they remembered that the scripture said this about him and that they had done this for him. The people who had been with Jesus when he called Lazarus out of the grave and raised him from death had reported what happened. That was why the crowd met him, because they heard that he had performed this miracle. The Pharisees then said to one another, "You see, we are not succeeding at all. Look, the whole world is following him."
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the service this morning. It's Palm Sunday, that moment in the church calendar when we think about that occasion of when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey and the crowds cheered and cried out, "Hosanna," which means "Save us, O Lord," and had echoes of years gone by when God had sent somebody to save a nation in crisis, and they were in crisis, and they thought their king was coming in the way that other kings had come before, in triumph, in might, in power. But the kind of might and power that was about to be revealed and unloosed by Jesus was the power of the cross, self-giving, sacrificial love. That's how God would save the world, not through the might of his arm or at the end of a sword, but with self-giving love. It's quite astonishing, isn't it? It's an astonishing event. And we often muse about the fact that how could this crowd that was one in one moment cheering him as king, in the next moment seeming to turn and to call for his execution. But that kind of displays how fickle our hearts are, really, doesn't it? Anyway, I won't go on anymore. It's good to be together this morning. And we've got some lovely things, I hope, for you this morning as we worship together. And we've got Jude is going to be sharing with us later on. It's a really great sermon. I have the privilege of seeing these things in advance, you see, and some worship and drama and all sorts of good things. I really do, as I say every week, appreciate everything everybody does. And it's played such a pivotal kind of part in us maintaining our kind of community worship through this difficult period in our history. But we're first going to start at that place where we should always start, and that's worship. And Myrtle and the team are going to lead us this morning in worship. So thank you. Over to Myrtle.
Your anthem, your renown. hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy. God, let your fire. Father, we welcome you with our songs. We welcome you with our songs of praise, with our anthems of shouts. We declare you are the King, you are the King, you are the King, you are the King. King of Kings, Majesty, God of Heaven, living in me, gentle Jesus, closest friend, strong deliverer, beginning and end.
Hello everyone, and I'm very pleased to introduce you to Danny Bonnet this morning. Morning, Danny.
Hello. Good morning, everybody. Hello, Heather.
Nice to see you, and thank you very much for doing this. Now, Danny has been part of the church for a little while, and I'm going to get him to tell you a bit about himself and his family, etc. So there you go, Danny. Have a shot at telling us all about you, your life, your family here in Thornbury, etc. That'd be great.
Okay, so I'm Danny Bonnet. I came to Thornbury in 2015. I was just thinking that it was almost exactly 6 years ago that myself and the Bonnets arrived in Thornbury. My family, I'm married to Joe, my wife Joe, and we've got two daughters, Zoe and Abby, who are both at the Castle School right now. So teenagers at the Castle School.
I'm very glad to be back there. Maybe.
Well, yeah, Zoe is and Abby isn't. So, it's quite interesting how different people react to it. But Zoe's, very social. So she's really enjoying being back at school, even though she's got her mocks, her mock GCSEs right now. So,
yeah, not an easy time then.
No, she's studying right now. So,
oh. Well, would you like to just explain to us what you do for a job, maybe?
Yeah, okay. So in fact, that's how we ended up in Thornbury, is that my job, I'm an engineer and I design structures and pretty much exclusively offshore wind turbines. And we lived in Hertfordshire, which was a little bit away from Joe's parents and also from my mother, who live further west. And I got offered a job in Bristol for a consultancy in offshore wind. And it happened to be a place where my wife, Jo, has got an office as well, near Thornbury. And so the stars aligned. So I ended up accepting this job in Bristol. And we moved from Hertfordshire, where we'd been for 10 years, when we put down lots of roots, so that I could take the new job. Jo could carry on with her job in a new office. So that was like really good fortune. And and the kids, it was just before they were about to start senior school. So it was a good time.
Sounds like a quite a big step to take then, back in 2015.
Yeah, it was a big step. I think we weren't planning a big move, but we had in our mind somehow that things needed to change. We needed to kind of reorganize where we were, and that all happened in 2015 when we moved to Thornbury. So and then we were really pleased, you know, to have ended up in Thornbury. My job's in Bristol, but so we were looking around Bristol, but actually we ended up in Thornbury. We very quickly came to the Baptist Church, which was a real blessing. And we were brought to the Baptist Church really because we heard about the great provision for children within the church. So we thought, you know, let's go there, let's try. And it was brilliant. We were comfortable immediately. So that was really good.
And we were very glad that you did come along as well. Now, you are something of an environmental warrior, I would say, really, aren't you? Your job, it kind of ties in with your passion for recycling and environmental issues. And I think you've done something of a cycle ride as well along those lines. So perhaps just tell us a little bit about that.
Yes. So I would say I've been certainly motivated by, I guess, by environmental issues for quite a long time, since about, certainly I directed my career in that place from 2002. So going back some decades now, that I moved into renewable energy. And I've also been involved with various sustainability initiatives in the town where I used to live, in Berkhamsted in Hertfordshire, and now here in Thornbury. And recently I did a bike ride. It was in 2019, actually, luckily pre-COVID, which was to raise money for a charity who have renewable energy solutions across the kind of less developed world, I think. So that was great, and that was a sponsored ride. I really enjoyed it, but it kind of fits very much with my kind of passion and my I think it's sort of my moral code, I suppose. Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. And how much does your faith motivate that? And how much does your faith come into your passion for these things?
I think it's a really important part of it. I don't think I knew at the beginning really what my motivations were. I just knew what I was really sort of keen on. But it's become much, much clearer, I think, as time has gone on for me, that that my faith and my strong belief in, you know, that commandment, you know, love your neighbor, is really certainly the driver for action on climate change. So climate change is only one part of it. But, you know, when we as kind of thinking, you know, thinking human beings, we can kind of work out that actually there's this connection between, you know, emitting fossil fuels and causing climate change, and then impacting on other human beings around the world, once we've kind of made that connection, then you realize that in order to love those people elsewhere in the world, you know, we have to do what we can to sort of mitigate that, because it's largely a negative thing, climate change. So we have to therefore mitigate it. So effectively, it's our, you know, I think that's what God wants us to do, but to use our brain to work out what we should do, and then to follow that. And he's given us, he obviously gives us like really simple things to do, like love your neighbor. That's not difficult. You know, climate change is difficult, but we can work it out. We can work out how to do the best by the planet, which I think is God's planet, and then by our fellow human beings.
It's a massive subject, and there's so much that we could do. And I have to say that you've given us lots of food for thought over the years with your ideas and your prompting. And can I just say, if anybody meets Danny and wants to talk to him about it, I'm sure you would be very happy to do so, wouldn't you, Danny?
Really. And I think it's so important. Like I say, once you've made the connection, I don't think you can't unmake it. Enabling about that is that then it goes, well, okay, there's this whole world of opportunities for actually how I can love my neighbor. I'm a good example of being like as flawed as anybody, in that I know there's so many things I could do that I don't do. That's just I suppose it's a human thing, but also the things that you do, you feel good about because you think you're doing the right thing. Anyway, you're trying to do the right thing.
Yeah, absolutely. So how can we sort of pray, or how do you pray with this in mind for our world, for our church, for our town? How can we pray for it, and maybe a few basic things that we can do?
Yeah,
probably a long list.
in a way, I don't. You know, I think that because it's a global issue. A lot of the answers, a lot of the answers lie with sort of governments. They're kind of global answers, but praying that people, first of all, that people kind of see the connection, how we're all connected together, and how it's our obligation really to love our neighbor. I think that would be my first prayer request. The next bit is just then demonstrating it. So effectively showing that you're willing to do whatever is the right thing. It's just a sign of willingness. And so praying that at different levels, governmentally, nationally, the town council, and as individuals, I think the main thing is just to show that the willingness to love our neighbor. And if we do that, then actually everything else will fall into place. The scientists will work out what's the right action. I think that's fine. We don't need to, employ a supercomputer ourselves. We just have to trust that God's showing us the right way. But then to show others around us that that's how we feel.
That's great advice, and a bit of a challenge there, I reckon, as well. But thank you, Danny. And I'm sure you will have other ways of challenging us in the future as we get together back at church, and the various things that you're involved with, and it's great to hear about them on an ongoing basis. So just keep doing what you're doing, and we will certainly pray and do our best to follow that. Thank you so much for chatting to us today, and hope to see you soon.
Thank you, Hannah.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Lord God, the only true God, you're the living God. You're sovereign and you're mighty. and you're beautiful, kind, and compassionate. And you welcome everyone who comes to visit you. Your love is so great that you gave us Jesus. You're the God who saves. You're the truth in a world where there are so many lies and so many half-truths. You are our safe place, our firm foundation. You are our fortress, and we thank you.
Merciful God, gracious Lord, we bring before you now those things which we've done in thought and word and deed, which have not been great, which have not glorified you. And we ask for forgiveness for our sins, Lord. And we just take a moment now to hand them over to you, Lord. Think about them this last week. So, Lord, we are truly sorry and repent of our sins and turn away from them, Lord. And we ask for your help with your Holy Spirit to do that. And, Lord, we also pray for this nation, that it would turn away from ways which are not in accordance with your will and look to you, Lord, as their Lord and Saviour. Thank you, Lord, that Jesus died upon the cross for our sins so that we could be set free and live lives in you. Amen.
Dear Lord, thank you for all that you're doing on this earth. Your purposes are not derailed by a virus. It is your desire that none would perish, but that all would find everlasting life. Thank you that 2,000 years ago you gave of yourself utterly, that we might come into your presence this day. You desire that none should perish, but that all peoples would find a home in you. Thank you for establishing your church throughout the world. And thank you that you've called each one of us to be a witness for you and of your goodness. Thank you for those who have worked tirelessly during this pandemic and for the strength and resolve that you have established in the hearts of each of us to be more outward looking towards the wider society. In spite of all the trauma and the loss, may the good things that this pandemic has brought not be lost. Thank you for your everlasting love.
Lord, please draw near to all who are not well and struggling within the TBC community. Please comfort and heal them. Lord, as we have just passed the anniversary of the lockdown restrictions starting, we ask you to be with those who have suffered from isolation, loneliness, and fear through this time. Help and strengthen them. Put your loving arms around them and guide us to help and to be your hands and feet. We ask you to bless the elders of TBC, particularly through this time of transition. Give them wisdom, Lord. We pray that you will bless and strengthen the church in this country and across the world, and that despite this challenging year when we've not been able to fellowship and worship together in person, that you will unite us and send your spirit on us. We pray for revival, that we will be able to meet you in a new way and draw close and to know your heart, to deepen our faith and to reach out to share your love with those in the communities around us. Lord, we need you. In your name we pray. Please hear our prayer. Amen.
So today is Palm Sunday and Abigail is just going to open her Easter bag. So I wonder if you ordered your Easter bag. If you didn't order an Easter bag but you'd still like to join in with our special activity, then you'll find the ingredients list as well as the recipe and how to do it on our website. Okay,
you got a bag! So the trail this year is based on this book, The Surprising Story, the Seriously Surprising Story, and it's the Easter story. So in there you should have a packet of Skittles!
Oh, I think I might know how to do this.
Yeah, and we've got a special Skittles prayer, Abby. Can you see what we have to do?
Okay.
Yeah, so we're going to have a go at that, and we're going to pray for those that we love. And then, Abigail, you've got a recipe. What's your recipe?
I don't know, Rocky Road.
Yeah, and it's a special Rocky Road. It's a Rocky Road through
Holy Week.
Holy Week. So you can use your recipe to go through the whole of the Holy Week story whilst you make Rocky Road, and then you have a tasty treat at the end of it. So Abigail, do you think you could help me as we make the Rocky Road?
Yeah.
Brilliant. We better get to the kitchen then. See ya. Okay. What else have you got in there, Abigail?
The next thing you're going to want to pull out is this party bag.
Yeah.
I wonder what's inside of it. Should I open it, Mum?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
You're going to want to use a cereal bowl size for mixing up in. So not for melting the chocolate, but for making up your Rocky Road.
What
so
is
Abigail,
surprise?
As you find the green sweet, Abigail, and show everyone the green sweet. The green sweet is to remind us of the green palm leaves that were waved on Palm Sunday when Jesus rode into Jerusalem.
Leftovers.
Hang on, so let's get you some scissors. No.
Leftovers.
And in a separate bowl, Abigail, we're going to break up the pieces of chocolate.
Really?
And we're going to melt them. We've put our chocolate in a bowl. You can either put it over a saucepan of boiling water, or it can go in the microwave. I think about when you break the chocolate, when Jesus got angry, when he turned over the tables in the temple. So people have been making some really wrong choices and they've been using the temple like it was just a marketplace, haven't they, Abby? So as you're breaking up the chocolate, think about Jesus as he was throwing those tables.
You've got some, Mummy. You've got some.
Anger. Right, that sounds like.
You've got some.
Everybody else has some raisins because the raisins remind us of when Jesus cursed the fig tree, but you don't like raisins.
Ew.
Yeah, you don't like raisins. And so those have been excluded, but this is the opportunity that you put the raisins in. Next, can you find the silver balls? But the silver balls are
They taste like raisins.
The silver balls are there to remind us of the money that Judas was given when Jesus was betrayed. So
we've got some melted chocolate. Be careful not to touch the bowl because the bowl is very hot.
Okay, so can you crush up the biscuits into small sections? And this is to remind us that how on the Thursday evening,
Pounder!
Maundy Thursday, as we know, Jesus broke the bread and he shared it with his friends and he
Look
passed
down.
The wine.
Definitely wants you to see that. Lovely.
Right, so I'm going to put them in your bowl.
Dump. Your chocolate.
Dump, 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 dump. Mix them up. Now, when Jesus broke the bread as he shared a meal with his friends, the disciples, he talked about the bread that he was breaking being like his body. And he was talking about how very soon he was about to die on the cross and his body would be broken so that ours could be healed, which is incredible. So we've also got some little Easter eggs, and the Easter eggs,
I love those things,
are going to go on the top, so we'll leave them there for a minute. You've got marshmallows, white marshmallows. Abigail's a fan.
I love those things. Don't
and the white
now.
Marshmallows.
Dump them in now.
I'm going to go in. Once Jesus had died, he was buried in a tomb and he was wrapped in linen. So can you put our marshmallows in, Abby?
I like rocky roads.
And then we have got a chocolate mint aero boulder. Unfortunately, I ran out. But that is to remind us that when Jesus was buried, he really was dead. And they put the stone across the tomb.
Is there actually any
So
there?
Now you need to mix this all together.
Watch the crushing.
I'm going to add a little bit of melted butter as well, and then it will be time to put the eggs on the top, and then we're going to put this in the fridge to set for about half an hour, and then you can enjoy. And as you bite through your rocky road, you can be reminded of the Easter story of what Jesus went through in that final week before he died on the cross and, more importantly, came back to life. Woo! So hope you have fun. Bye!
Hello and welcome to Jerusalem News. It has been an event-filled day in Jerusalem. Today marks the beginning of the week-long Passover celebration. People by the thousands have entered the city as required by the law of Moses. Pilgrims from all over the world are swelling the number of people in Jerusalem to over four times the usual population. The big news story, however, is not the usual mass migration for the feast, but the arrival of Jesus of Nazareth. This controversial rabbi came riding into the city on a donkey, accompanied by his disciples and surrounded by a multitude of people. For more on his arrival, we take you to Elijah Ben Shur.
Thanks, Joseph. I'm standing on a 2-mile road that connects the village of Bethany with the city of Jerusalem. A few hours ago, Jesus the rabbi from Nazareth passed by this very spot. According to one of his disciples, he had spent the night in Bethany at the home of his good friends Lazarus, Mary and Martha. You may recall that Lazarus was the man who claimed that Jesus raised him from the dead several weeks ago. As Jesus left Bethany, some of his disciples fetched a donkey for him to ride on. Jesus mounted it and began his journey. A crowd from the city quickly gathered around him, curious to meet the man who allegedly raised Lazarus from the dead and to welcome him to the city. Earlier, I spoke with the man who lent his donkey to Jesus and asked him why he had agreed to let him take it.
Well, I don't know really. It was only a young'un. Some of his followers came and said, the Lord needs it. And I just knew I should trust and do what they asked. Couldn't tell you why, I just knew I should.
There's something special about that Jesus.
And what happened when Jesus of Nazareth rode into the city on this young donkey?
Well, the mood was festive. With me, here is Rebecca. She was there in the crowd. Rebecca, what happened?
Well, some people took their coats off and spread them on the road for the donkey to walk on. And others tore down branches from the palm trees nearby and spread them on the road or waved them in the air. The crowds were huge. It was really exciting. We were all cheering and shouting. Here comes the king, and blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, some people think that he's come to rescue us from the Romans. But me, I'm not so sure. I mean, would a warrior king come riding on a little donkey? I'm not holding my breath.
Thank you. There's a lot of expectation for Jesus to see what he does next. The people of Jerusalem will be watching to see how events unfold in the next week or so. Back to you in the studio, Joseph.
Elijah Ben-Shur there on the Bethany Road. The most striking and disturbing event of the day took place when Jesus reached the temple. Elizabeth has this report.
It is unbelievable what took place here this afternoon. The temple court is a mess. Throughout much of the day, temple servants and money changers sat behind tables, collecting the temple tax from worshippers and selling animals and birds approved for sacrifice. I spoke to one of the sellers, who was there when it all happened.
Well, when Jesus arrived, he was really angry. He overturned the tables of the money changers, leaving some of them broken, the money scattered all over the ground. He opened the cages that contained lambs and doves. It was bedlam. As he overturned the tables and drove us out, I heard him say, "My house will be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." Really? We're just trying to help folk out. We've provided animals for sacrifice and, well, we've got a living to make too.
There are rumours that making a living is not all that goes on in those courts. But for now, things are being tidied up and returning to normal.
Thank you, Elizabeth. All is quiet in the city now, at least as quiet as can be expected considering the unusual events of the day. But many are left wondering what it all means. Now, over to Mark with the weather.
Today is Palm Sunday, the start of Holy Week and the beginning of the events that led to Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. In our drama, we met some of the characters from this episode in Jesus' life. And as we prepare for Easter, I'd like to think about some of the ways in which we are similar to these people. The first group are the crowds lining the streets. Most of these people would have travelled to Jerusalem just for the Passover festival. This was a time of celebration, a time to meet up with friends and family. Anyone remember what that was like? No, me either. And there would have been a sense of excitement and anticipation. Many of them would have come across Jesus in the previous 3 years of his ministry. They might have heard him teach, or they might have seen him perform miracles, or they may have just heard of him. And when he rode into the city, they treated him as a king. You don't lay your cloak down on a dusty, dirty road for just anyone. You lay it down for a king. But what sort of king were they expecting? What did they imagine that a king was going to do for them? I suspect that most of them had the idea that Jesus, if he was the Messiah, was there to rescue them from the Romans, that he would solve their immediate problem. They had an idea of who they wanted him to be or what they wanted him to do. And when he didn't turn out to do or to be those things, on Good Friday, they turned away from him.
How often do we pray with a preconceived idea of what we want God to do for us? How often do we ask God for guidance in a situation, but really we just want him to rubber stamp our own plans? I know I have. But God had a much better plan for his people. Not an immediate rescue from oppression, but a long-term rescue from deeper evil. In Acts chapter 10, verse 43, Peter tells Cornelius, "All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." Forgiveness of sins, that is pretty amazing. But the crowds thought they knew what they needed. They didn't wait to see what God had planned. Jesus didn't meet their narrow expectations, so they gave up on him. Do we tend to do that too? Is God not answering our prayers in the way we're expecting? Do we give up? Or are we ready for a different answer, to wait and to see what amazing thing God has in store instead? The next group I want to look at are the money changers and the sellers in the temple. Sacrifice was part of worship in the temple, allowing people to get closer to God. This was a really important thing. The pilgrims had travelled a long way on foot to reach Jerusalem, and you wouldn't want to bring an animal with you because it might get attacked or injured or stolen along the way, and then it wouldn't be a perfect sacrifice. So these people in the temple are serving the pilgrims. The sellers and the money changers are there to do something which helps with worship. Well, that's great. However, this service to others has become something which serves themselves. They're cheating people out of money. They're charging too much. They're not being honest and fair. And on top of this, this area of the temple is where the Gentile court is. This is where non-Jews can come and to learn about the one true God. But what a witness to them. Corruption, self-interest. Can we see ourselves here? Well, hopefully none of us are committing fraud, but have we set out to serve the church and instead made it all about us? What's our motivation for service? Or maybe we're preventing others from seeing the one true God by the way that we behave. Colossians 3 verse 17 says, "And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God." Do it all, every part of our lives for Jesus. So our final character is actually the one we meet first, but I wanted to leave them to the end. The owner of the donkey. He or she, the Bible doesn't tell us which, is asked to do something for Jesus without knowing why. They trust him completely. They say yes, even though there may be some personal cost to them. They don't know if they'll ever see their donkeys again. Following Christ is not promised to be easy, but they are humble and they're ready to serve. Are we open and ready to let Jesus use us and our possessions in the way that he wants, not in the way that we have planned? The donkey owner wasn't looking for a way to serve Jesus, but when it came, he was ready. God might simply be asking us to speak to someone in particular or to give to a specific need. Or he might be calling you to a whole new direction in your life. Are we ready and open when he needs us, however small or big that might be? Or maybe we're willing to be like the donkey. Corrie ten Boom was once asked if it was difficult for her to remain humble. Her reply was this: "When Jesus rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday on the back of a donkey, and everyone was waving palm branches and throwing garments onto the road and singing praises, do you think that for one moment it ever entered the head of that donkey that any of that was for him? If I can be the donkey on which Jesus Christ rides in his glory, I give him all the praise and all the honour. Are we ready to humble ourselves and take Jesus where he needs to go? I think that what we can take from these characters can be summed up in Micah 6, verse 8. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. As we approach Easter and remember what Christ gave for us, let's be ready to say to him, what do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? To humbly say, not my will, but yours. This can be hard and we can't do it through our own strength. So let's ask God to help us. Let's pray. Lord, we're sorry for the times we have followed our own desires, for the times we've put ourselves first. Please forgive us. Please help us to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, God. Amen.
See?
That was brilliant, wasn't it? Thank you, everybody, for taking part this morning. Great drama, brilliant talk, Jude. Wonderful last song from Megan. That's a new one from Megan. Really, really appreciated that, and Myrtle's leadership as well. We are so blessed as a church community to be served in this way by all of these good people. Just one or two things to say to you that's important. Please put it in your diary. Starting on Monday, that's the 29th, that's this Monday, prayer week. The prayer garden in the church is open from 8 in the morning to 8 in the evening. You can turn up. There are prayer stations, hopefully something that will help you engage with God over this Holy Week period. So please do that. Please go there and do that. Alongside that, the other churches around the town are taking part, and they've got various things going on at their buildings and around their buildings also. There's a prayer walk, there's a map available. In fact, it featured in the Gazette, I think, this last week. Isn't that exciting to make the Gazette? Wow. So there we are. Please engage with the prayer week. Then on Good Friday, there's a Good Friday service. It will be premiered at 6 o'clock on YouTube and Facebook and on the church website, which is something for you to engage with as we prepare our hearts for this weekend. It will be a reflective service with lots and lots of different people contributing, so that's a really good thing too. And then on Easter Sunday morning, there will be a service online, Facebook, YouTube, website, at 10:30 in the morning, and also at the church building. You can book your place from Monday morning. You can go on there and book your place. Places will be limited, so if you want to come along, please do. Just bear in mind that it will be socially distanced, it will be wearing masks, and there won't be any singing. Sorry about that. Hopefully these things will change in the near future, we hope. So please do come along to that. So there you go. Prayer week, Good Friday service, Easter Sunday service. And just to flag up, after the Easter Sunday service, there will be an online chat for those who like to get together and have a bit of a chin wag after the service. That will start at about 11:30, and it will be good to see you there. Anyway, God bless you this week. I pray that this Holy Week would be a week of encounter for you as you turn your heart towards God, that you would receive his grace upon grace, that you would come face to face with the Jesus who laid down his life for love's sake. May God bless you this week in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Abide in me. Abide in me. Send your Holy Spirit. Come and abide in me. Whatever it takes, create in me the space. Make my heart a place designed for thee.